Welcome. I'm Brother Eric John Phelps, Biblical Truth and History and Prophecy, coming to you today, this beautiful 28th day of October, and this broadcast is for white men. White men who are Bible-believing, historically Protestant and Baptist, white men who speak English and don't want Spanish for a second language. Although we do speak other languages, we have our civic language for our nation, have designated that to be English. We are white men who wish to have our own nation somewhere here in North America, where we can have our own borders, where we can protect our race, our language, our culture, our historic white Anglo-Saxon Protestant and Baptist heritage, having sprung out of England and Germany and Holland and other Northern European countries, which brought the world out of the Pope's Dark Ages after the first 30 years war from 1618 to 1648, and have brought the world such wonderful scientific inventions as the light bulb, as the toilet, so we don't have to use a chamber pot, as locomotion like electromagnetism or even internal combustion engines, steam engines, the advance in technology that has made our lives, given us lots of time to be able to do other things like research and investigation, where we don't have to be constantly busy foraging for food to eat. All of this was a result of white men who spoke English, who believed the Bible, who used the sword of the Spirit in one hand, the Word of God, and the sword of just defense, the weapon, the gun, in the other, subordinate to a group of leaders called their government who wanted to promote that. And that's what we want back. This empire, this American empire, has nothing for us. Nothing. There is no difference between Barack Obama and John McCain. None. They're both wicked sinners. They're both Freemasons. They're both serving the papacy. They're both frying each other. At the Archbishop's Al Smith dinner just earlier this month, having a ball while people are losing their homes and their life savings and their jobs. Everything's a joke to these people. And the joke's on us. Both of them are going to let these millions of alien Roman Catholic savage invaders into this country and let them stay here in violation of the law. Both of them are going to continue the Pope's crusade into Iraq. Both of them are going to continue. Both of them signed off on this horrible reorganization and grand theft, huge grand theft on Wall Street just a couple of weeks ago. I tell you this, if there was any difference between those two, one of them would have said, well, I'm not going along with this. If Barack Obama wants change, if he wants something different, don't you think he would have said, I'm not going along with this? The only difference between him and McCain is McCain's learned how to lie a little bit longer than Barack, but I'm sure Barack will catch up to him. Let's wake up, white men. And another thing, I'm more convinced than ever that John McCain is going to be our next military dictator, our next Holy Roman Emperor here, in the Pope's Holy Roman 14th Amendment corporate fascist socialist communist empire established on July 28, 1868 with the declaration of the ratification of the 14th Amendment. John McCain is going to be the next emperor. You know how we know? Because John McCain was sitting at the right hand of God there at St. Patrick's Cathedral at the Al Smith dinner. Edward Cardinal Egan. That's who he thinks he is. Egan thinks he's the ambassador of God over there in Rome, the Pope. Did you know, Roman Catholics, that the Pope thinks he is God on earth? And therefore all of his archbishops and cardinals are representative of God? And so, yes, McCain was at the right hand of Cardinal Egan at the Al Smith dinner. Just like George W. Bush, skull and bones George W. Bush, was at the right hand of Cardinal Egan in 2000 at the Al Smith dinner when Al Gore was on the left. Just like in 1960, John F. Kennedy was at the right hand of Cardinal Spellman and Richard Nixon was on the left-hand side. If we are to learn anything from these pictures, from the history of this dinner, it is John McCain's turn to go to the Jesuit Andrew White House, where he can administer this country for the Pope, just like Bush and Clinton and Reagan and Carter and Nixon and Johnson and Ford and all those other sinners. There is no difference between the political parties except Tweedledee and Tweedledum. Don't you give me your propaganda, Fox News Network, or you, CNN Network, you propagandizers, liars. And that's how you make your living, telling lies, deceiving the simple in heart. We're too busy working and slaving away every day, trying to make a living so they can come and feed their children and have a warm place to sleep, and they don't have the time to dig out all these facts, which are absolutely dangerous, who dare to call themselves Americans. That's why we need our own state. It's time for Pennsylvania to secede. We don't need Washington anymore. We don't need Rome on the Potomac. We don't need the Archbishop of New York. We are going to secede. Our own state, and then for the blacks in our nation, the blacks may have their own portion of Pennsylvania. They can have their own nation. The vast majority of blacks want their own country. Give them their own country! You say you're a black nationalist? Absolutely I am, because nationalism is biblical. You're a white nationalist? Absolutely I am. Nationalism is biblical. Diversity is perversity. Michael Savage is absolutely right on that point. A race is a nation is a race of people with a specific language, with a common heritage, living on specific geographical boundaries. That is what a nation is, and America is no longer a nation. It is an empire, just as Rome was, and it's going to fall just as Rome did. Brother Eric John Phelps, Biblical Truth and History and Prophecy. I trust you're enjoying the broadcast today. I have with me my guest, Brother Daryl Eberhardt, but I want to say a few more things and then we will continue on. In the providence of God, I came across today a couple more men who were Knights of Malta. Robert Zolick. Zoellick. Robert Zolick. You know who Robert Zolick is? We should know who he is by the power that he wields. Well, he was appointed by that papal slave, George W. Bush, that bonesman and Freemason, that papal slave that he was appointed to head the World Bank. Robert Zolick, heading the World Bank, Knight of Malta. Hey, Lindsay Williams, I want to tell you something now. Remember, you're telling all of us that it's the World Bank behind the oil crisis and behind the manipulation of the prices? Hey, well, Lindsay, this guy right here, Robert Zolick, he's a Knight of Malta. Why don't you tell us about him, Lindsay? You supposed Baptist preacher, if you are a Baptist preacher, you will tell the truth no matter what it costs you. And the men you've been talking to, the men who said you're backing McCain, the men who said we're going to drop oil to $50 to $60 a barrel, exactly what has happened. Why don't you tell us these men are Knights of Malta? Robert Zolick, Knight of Malta, head of the World Bank. Let's go to another one. Richard Torrenzano. Richard Torrenzano, Knight of Malta. You know what he is? Well, he's a spokesman for the New York Stock Exchange. My, my. A spokesman for the New York Stock Exchange. Yeah, the Knights of Malta run the stock exchange. They run that casino up there, and they know what's going to happen every day, and they make millions of dollars every day knowing all the inside trades, while the poor souls that invest in the stock exchange seeking to have a larger portfolio and really trying to want to build a country with funding corporations, they get waxed! How about another one? How about another one? Here's John Robert Bolton. He was at the UN, a representative of the UN for the U.S. He's a Knight of Malta. But look what also he's involved with. The Jewish Institute for National Security Affairs, JINSA. Gee, do you think there's a connection between the Knights of Malta and the this Jewish Institute for National Security Affairs, as well as the World Jewish Congress? Do you think the Knights of Malta have anything to do with those Jewish organizations? They run them. They run them. Let's look at another one. Edward I. Hennessy. Edward L. Hennessy, pardon me. Edward L. Hennessy, Jr. He's a Knight of Malta. I mentioned him in my book, Vatican Assassins. He is a director of the New York Stock Exchange. So here's another Knight of Malta in the New York Stock Exchange. How about telling us about that guy, Tex? How about you, Alex Jones? How about you, Noel? How about telling us about the Knights of Malta in New York running the banks? Well, it's all the Jews, huh? Come on now, you got to deal with these facts. And you know how you guys deal with them? You ignore them. You know why? Because you're coadjutors. You're not stupid, and you're not gutless. So that only leaves one other solution. You're coadjutors, busy serving the Pope, seeking to direct our attention away from the Vatican onto some impotent Jews who are nothing more than creatures and surrogates for the Pope. Look at here, Edward L. Hennessy, he's also a director of the Federal Reserve Bank in New York. Along with Timothy Geithner, you sinner! How about another one? Here is Lord Guthrie of Craigbank. Lord Guthrie of Craigbank. He's a Knight of Malta. Now look at where he's from, Lord Guthrie, G-U-T-H-R-I-E of Craigiebank. He was a representative to the Trilateral Commission from guess where? From N.M. Rothschild and Sons. Here's a Knight of Malta working for Nathan M. Rothschild and Sons, really running it, and he was a representative to the Trilateral Commission. Yeah, that's right. All the Rothschild interests are controlled directly or indirectly by the Knights of Malta, and just look up Lord Guthrie if you don't believe me. The Rothschilds are the Pope's court Jews, at the best of keepers of the Pope's Vatican treasury. And one more. Edwin J. Fulner, Knight of Malta, president of Heritage Foundation. He was the founder of it, actually, financed by Richard Mellon Scaife out of Pittsburgh. There's another Roman Catholic Knight of Malta. But look here. Here's Edwin J. Fulner. He's International Monetary Fund and World Bank insider, sent by the U.S. to the World Bank. All of these men are Knights of Malta. All of them are busy serving the Pope. All of them are seeking to make a world government under the Pope from a rebuilt Hebrew temple in Jerusalem, making a Jerusalem a new world capital. And this is completely in accord with what the papacy wants. This is what the Vatican wants. one verse of Scripture, and then we shall continue. Ephesians 5:11. And having no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. The purpose for this ministry, the purpose for this broadcast, is to reprove, to bring to light the unfruitful works of darkness, which the papacy and anybody else, which ultimately will be traced to them, is engaged in, that we might know what to do. And thus I have my guest with me today, Brother Daryl Eberhardt. Welcome, Daryl, to the program.
Hi, Brother Eric. Good to be on with you again. And I'd like, as I always do anymore when I'm on air, is ask the listeners during the half-hour break to grab a pen or pencil and some paper, because I've got some information, some updated prices and stuff of books. Also, I found out where you can get Roman Catholicism by Lorraine Bettner without having to order it via the mail. I want to read one Bible verse, and I've been doing this one a lot lately. It's in Luke 4, verse 4. And Jesus answered him, and he's having a conversation with Lucifer, Satan, by the way, in this passage here. And Jesus answered him, saying, "It is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God." And how can we live by every word of God if we don't read the whole Bible? So I just want to emphasize to everyone, giving them my personal testimony, that about 15 years ago I started doing that, reading from Genesis in the Old Testament to Revelation in the New Testament, the last book in the New Testament, each year. Something I am ashamed that I didn't start about over 50 years ago, but about 15 years ago I started doing that, and I would urge everyone to do that, because we're in the sad shape we're in this country today, because most people who call themselves Christians are biblically illiterate. And what a crying shame that, Brother Eric, as you know, the price that was paid by men like William Tyndale and others to get the Bible printed and trying to distribute it, when Papal Rome had hits put out on men like William Tyndale and murdered anybody that was caught even in possession of, not to mention distributing or printing up the Holy Bible. And I think that's important. I want to read a quote, because later, if we have time, Brother Eric, I'd like to talk a little bit about Oscar Romero. That's one of the many newsletters that I had up on my website several years ago at 106 that, you know, got knocked out because I used a few Seventh-day Adventist quotes and recommended a few books by Seventh-day Adventists. And no, I'm not a Seventh-day Adventist. Let me read this quote here, because it ties in with a lot that's gone on in Latin America. Any people have really suffered under the Roman Catholic Church. It's been the poor people in Europe and those in Latin America. This is a quote by, and I probably got it out of your book probably at one time, Eric, is Emmanuel M. Josephson in 1968 said this about the Jesuits and their propensity for backing revolutionary movements and always having their people in it. As a matter of fact, I'm going to give two quotes. The first one here is by Josephson. And they're talking about, he's talking about Jesuit-trained illuminist Adam Weishaupt. So he says, "Weishaupt's success in forcing the Vatican to reestablish the abolished Jesuit order through revival of the Church's original Nazarene communism in the form of present-day communism led to the conspiracy's control by the Society of Jesus," in other words, the Jesuits. Continuing the quote, "Whenever a totalitarian movement erupts, whether communist or Nazi, a Jesuit can be found in the role of advisor or leader. In Cuba, Father," and I don't speak Spanish, "but Armando Llorente, and in Argentina, the neo-Nazis are led by Father," and I guess it's Menville, M-E-N-V-I-E-I-L-L-E. The point I want to make here is that you look at guys like Mussolini, one of his top advisors was a Jesuit named Pietro Tacci Venturi. Hitler, put into power by a Roman Catholic Knight of Malta named Franz von Papen, and the Monsignor Koss, who I believe was a Jesuit, who was the head of the Roman Catholic Centrum Party. These guys are always either backing the dictators Roman Catholic dictators especially, or they actually, as Monsignor Tiso, the Jesuit, they put them in the actual position of running the country, as Slovakia, as you mentioned in your excellent book, Vatican Assassins, the first country that started shipping not only Jews, but Protestants to the death camps. As you know, Eric, I just recently picked up the book, The Jesuits, by Malachi Martin. I'm not recommending it to anyone yet, because I haven't read hardly any of it. But there's an interesting little quote here about Nicaragua. On page 63 of Malachi Martin, his book, The Jesuits, and here's what it says. From its very first days in power, the Sandinista junta included those same five loyal and youthful priests in the new government at cabinet-level posts. Jesuit, again, I don't speak Spanish, Jesuit Fernando Cardenal, Jesuit Alvaro Arguello, Father Ernesto Cardenal, Mary Knoll, Father Miguel De Soto Brockman, and Diocesan Father Edgar Perales. So, did you notice that in your research, brother? Of course, that my tongue's in my cheek right now. That Jesuits are all over the map in these revolutions and that. Did you ever notice that?
I think maybe once or twice.
Okay. Anyway, you mentioned McCain. And by the way, I wouldn't recommend it. I agree 100% with Eric that at the national level, Republicans and the Democrats are totally controlled by Papal Rome. But I got my newsletter from the Gun Owners of America, Larry Pratt, and they have the ratings for the people in Congress as concerns gun control. And, of course, they have them for the presidential race also. And McCain gets a C-, which is a pretty bad grade, which means he's a gun grabber.
Yep.
And on the Democratic, well, Palin gets an A+, but, you know, what role is she really going to play in a McCain presidential administration? For the Democrats, oh, this is a really good one. You know, hardly anyone on, I looked through a bunch of these congressmen and stuff, hardly anyone got an F-, but both Obama and Biden got F-, from Gun Owners of America, rating them on the issue of gun control. So we know what these people want to do, and that's to take away our guns. So, again, I'm not recommending who anyone should vote for. I'm just letting them know at the top level we don't have a choice and haven't had a choice for quite a while. Sounds like we might have a break coming up soon, Brother Eric, but by the way, before it starts, I guest hosted Greg Szymanski's broadcast last Thursday, and since you mentioned Tex-Mars, I threw out a challenge to Tex-Mars, not that he would be listening, but hoping that one of his listeners was, and that he would, I'll finish that up whenever we get back from the break.
Okay. Eric John Phelps, Biblical Truth and History and Prophecy, with guest today, Daryl Everhart, and turn after the station identification.
The program you are listening to is 100% sponsored by you, the listener, on this First Amendment Rights Media channel. You will notice that there are few commercials on this radio network. There's a good reason for that. Corporate advertising dollars come with strings that limit program content. So without your help, these programs cannot continue on internet or our several affiliates. If you benefit by the educational law programs, we ask you to give. If you are admonished or nurtured by the Bible and ministry programs, we ask you to give. If some voice a cause that you are passionate about, we ask you to give. If you believe in any of these, we ask you to support them as you would a missionary on a continual basis, as if giving a tithe for missionary radio. These programs are not commercially viable and must be supported by those faithful to the cause of truth. Look for the button to sponsor your favorite programs at our Listen and Schedule pages on the Internet. Then, when you subscribe, we will send you the last quarterly MP3 CD of that program immediately, and continue to do so with each new quarter. We will also give you unlimited archive access to all of our programs. We're asking you to give much less than a tithe, so that you may also send support directly to a particular program host, cause, and anywhere else the Spirit may lead you. Do all to the glory of our God and Creator, for His holy nation, the only kingdom that will last forever. Thank you for listening.
Visit crosstheborder.org, C-R-O-S-S, crosstheborder.org, to get your print, EPUB, or PDF version of the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. That's crosstheborder.org.
I know you all want answers, and believe me, so do I, and I'll do my best to get them.
Despite Nicolas Cage's promise to do his best to get Left Behind rapture answers for us, don't hold your breath. Not everyone believes Left Behind is true prophecy. Some may even regard as conspiratorial the mainstream re-release of the Left Behind movie, with actor Nicolas Cage portraying the main character, as an attempt to further reinforce in the minds of all this perception of false prophecy, in order to condition the masses for the play about to begin. If you want true Bible prophecy answers, get the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. The author exposes the Latin rapture origin, the seven-year tribulation deception, true Bible revelation of Daniel's 70 weeks, the abomination of desolation, the restrainer, America in the revelation, the image of the beast, and the mark of the beast, and the truth about God's chosen people, and so much more about Bible prophecy. This book will shatter the Left Behind paradigm of future events. Get the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. Visit crosstheborder.org, C-R-O-S-S, crosstheborder.org, to get your print, EPUB, or PDF version of the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. That's crosstheborder.org.
Eric John Fellows, Biblical Truth and History and Prophecy. We're back for the second half. And my guest is Tuesday with me, Daryl Everhart. And before we begin, I would just like to mention that I have a book for sale, Vatican Assassins, Wounded in the House of My Friends. It's 836 pages. And after I finish this printing, I don't believe I'm going to print any more of them. We have about 40 of them left. And then I will always have the CD, Vatican Assassins, plus the free CD. And then I have my PowerPoint, which I have extended to nearly 500 slides, because I wanted to thoroughly document in chronological order the events, dates, places, and names of the signing over of the Temple Mount to the papacy, so that any of you who don't believe it can have first-hand proof. You can consult the very newspapers and the investigative journalists that reported it, and I have it there on my PowerPoint, culminating in the traitor, Shimon Peres, who, for the Oslo Accord, which included the provision of signing over the holy sites of the Old City to the Pope, he was given the Nobel Peace Prize in 1994. So it's all going to be there on the PowerPoint. I have the Engineer Court of Hell, which is one of the most important books ever written by an American on the Jesuit order, written in 1883, and that's for $10. So please call me at 610-589-5300, 610-589-5300, or you can email me at eric@vaticanassassins.org, Eric at VaticanAssassins.org. Hey, Brother Darrell.
Yeah, and just before we went to break, I had mentioned I guest hosted Greg Szymanski's broadcast on last Thursday. And since you had mentioned that Tex Mars, the email, you had read it on one of your previous broadcasts, I think it was last Tuesday when I was on with you, and where Tex says that your book is full of errors. So I said, hey, Tex Mars, if you're listening, and of course I knew he probably wasn't, but hoping that one of his followers was, that they would pass that on to him. And I said, hey, Tex, why don't you debate Eric John Phelps on his broadcast or on Greg Szymanski? I'm sure Greg would like to set that up. That'd be 2 hours worth. And point out where Eric's book is full of errors, because I would really like to know, and I don't want to know a typo or something. I want to know historical errors, major historical errors that Eric has in his book, because I read your original book, Vatican Assassins, which I think Wounded in the House of My Friends, the first edition, that Tex Mars interestingly carried for a while, and it was heavily, a tremendous bibliography, heavily footnoted, lots of references and quotes from other writers, many of them from over 100 years or more ago, that were much closer to the events. And so I just, again, throw that out. If there's a listener here that still gets Power of Prophecy newsletter, how about emailing or writing or calling Texas Ministry at Power of Prophecy and ask him if he would like to debate Eric John Phelps and point out how his book is full of errors. Because, again, I don't think Tex is going to be able to do that, Eric, because
Yeah, that's generally true. There were probably a couple errors, and one error I learned from Michael Collis Piper. And so I conferred with Barry Chambers about that when I said that, concerning the assassination of Kennedy, that he was a friend of Israel. It turned out that he was not. He was not a friend of Ben-Gurion. He did not want to go along with giving nuclear technology to Israel. The popes revived Latin Kingdom of Jerusalem, and for that reason, that was another reason that they got rid of him. So I checked with Barry Chambers on that. He's substantiated. So my third edition, I changed it, and I corrected it. So that major mistake was corrected. There was also a mistake when I called Edward Mandel House a Jew. Edward Mandel House was no Jew. He was Dutch and English. He was a white Gentile. So I have that page in my book that I have made right in the front of the book, so when people can turn into it, they see my first errata, and they can make a note of that on other pages. So there were a few mistakes, but I've tried my best to correct them. And if there are others, I am open to correction also, because I am nothing. The theme, the story is everything, and it will take a host of devoted and hardworking men to put the rest of these facts together so we have a clear picture of exactly what's happening.
Well, I'm going to tell you, I don't think that was a major error, Michael Collins Piper's additional reason, because you covered the major reasons, and they could have easily, through their people in the FBI and the Atomic Energy Commission and the CIA, made sure that Israel got those secrets whether Kennedy lived or not. And they could have, so again, I don't see that as a major one. I see the major reasons that John Kennedy was killed was because he, number one, crossed the Roman Catholic Church. He dissed them, as some people like to say. He showed them disrespect by refusing, wasn't it, Cardinal, Spellman, refusing to allow him to do mass, perform mass in the White House. But, betrayed the mafia. Which is tied right in with the Vatican they figured he owed them for what was it, West Virginia and Illinois, that they helped ensure that would vote for him. But I think the main reason was, number one, disrespecting the Roman Catholic Church and not being a good little slave worker for them, but number two is he was going after the intelligence community, especially the Central Intelligence Agency. He and Bobby were gone after organized crime, but to fire Alan Dulles, whom you have reported was a Knight of Malta and a high-level Freemason, they fired General Charles Cobble, they were getting ready to transfer black operations, covert operations from the CIA to the Pentagon, where it would be exclusively belonging to the Pentagon, and all printing up money outside of the Federal Reserve. He did about four or five things, Eric, that I think far greater than what Michael Collins Piper put forward. Those other reasons would have, any one of them would have gotten a president murdered. And Kennedy did about five major ones. He said he was going to splinter the CIA into 1,000 pieces.
That's right. He also said
Bobby and he hated, and it was a mutual hatred, both Lyndon Johnson and J. Edgar Hoover, the director of the FBI, that claimed for decades that there was no organized crime in this country, so that ought to tell you something. They were going to force him into retirement. They were going to force him out. So I don't see Piper's reason as a major thing, and it certainly wasn't a major error on your part. I don't even list it in what I've written about the murder of JFK, because I see it as a minor thing. I see the major reasons as the ones I just stated. Anyway, he has the courage to, get with Greg Szymanski or yourself and schedule a debate, because I think it needs to be aired out. And I don't think he's going to be able to produce much, to tell you the truth. And I don't even think he'll jump on a debate, but he ought to, because he's one of the ones that, as we mentioned the last time I was on with you, he used to be kind of balanced. And by the way, the thing that the video that you had mentioned, he had put out some things about Papal Rome. He had criticized the pedophilia, and I like that. At one time, he may still do, carried that audio tape by Sister Charlotte, but he put out a good, one or two good VHS tapes. One was called Vatican Rising, which was a pretty good tape. But all of a sudden, about 2 to 3 years ago, Tex went from being what I used to, I think I gave him this nickname, an equal opportunity basher, because he went after gun control, the environmental movement, a little bit after Papal Rome. But all of a sudden, about 2 to 3 years ago, he shifted. Almost 80% of his ministry was going all exclusively after the Jews, Zionists, Israel, and the Jewish neocons that he certainly indicated were running, the White House and the U.S. government, basically. So, yeah, Tex needs to have the guts to step forward and show, point out errors and convince us all that the Jews are running everything and not the Jesuits, as you and myself and a few others, Greg Szymanski, John Daniel, and others point out. By the way, if folks are interested, I've written about four articles that deal with this Jew. Is it the Jews or the Papal Rome, Jesuit-controlled Papal Rome, I should say? They're running everything. I've got I think it's about 54 multiple-choice quiz. Let me give my website. It's toughissues.org. Tough Issues, issues is plural, I-S-S-U-E-S, .org. And so just click on, I think I've got about 40 articles up there right now. I once had 106, but click on multiple choice quiz. You'll find there's about, like I said, either 52 or 54 multiple choice questions that deals with this issue. Is it the Jews, or is it the Jews, the Zionists, and Jewish neocons in Israel running the world, or is it Jesuit-controlled Papal Rome? I've got an article up there, about 8 or 9 pages, on the Protocols of the Learned Elders of Zion, which Tex Mars, to the best of my knowledge, still has been for at least 2 years, and I believe still sells out of his Ministry Power Prophecy, a nice Jesuit work, but it wasn't done by Jews.
That's right. I analyze the protocols.
I brought this out in your book, A Satire Against the Jesuits in France. The third one is the real controllers. I think that's one of the earlier ones I wrote about that, who's really running the world. And the other one is, it is simply amazing. You'll find it just labeled simply amazing. So if you look, dear listener, if you believe the Jews are running everything, check those out. And also, I've got one up on my website called Bloody Hands. Take a look at that and see if it's the Jews that were running around killing everybody, or was it Roman Catholic crusaders who even went into southern France and killed just about every Bible-believing Christian. They were called the Albigensian Christians. They weren't Manichaeans. They weren't heretics. They were just simple Bible-believing Christians that were murdered and slaughtered by professional armies, including guys who had come back from the Crusades in the Middle East. So
that's right.
I think that issue really needs to be brought out, because there's a certain element in the alternative media that is certainly blaming everything on the Jews. And if you'll read Bloody Hands, you'll find out that the biggest slaughterer of murderer of Jews, Bible-believing Christians, Orthodox Christians, Protestants, has been the Roman Catholic Church, or as I say now more correctly, Jesuit-controlled Papal Rome. I said I wanted to talk. Well, let me give a couple more websites, Brother Eric. And I want to tell them your website you already mentioned, but VaticanAssassins.org. Assassins is plural. VaticanAssassins.org. You've got a ton of great articles up on your website. I'd urge them to read that. But especially when they go up there, on your homepage, on the top left, you have Order Book. And that tells them how they can get your, I think it's 1,836 page, updated, third edition, CD-ROM and PDF format. I'm going by memory here. I think you've got 760 portraits and photos and stuff in it. To get that CD-ROM in PDF format, called Vatican Assassins, the third edition. And also, you mentioned, you also throw in another CD-ROM in PDF format with 13 rare books that used in writing that. So if they can afford $45 postage paid, you'll get two CD-ROMs that'll give you enough reading for a couple weeks, at least, if you're a fast reader. I consider your work, Eric, to be the epitome of the great expose on the Jesuit order, showing clearly that they're the ones that foment wars and revolution. They're the ones that run around assassinating heads of state. They're the ones that have been, and that's where I got so much of my information on how many times they were expelled, even from Roman Catholic countries. Some of those Roman Catholic countries threw the Jesuits out at least three times, Portugal, Spain, and France, I think, predominantly Roman Catholic countries, tossed them out. Of course, they were tossed out of a good many countries in Latin America also. So if you can afford that $45, please do that. That helps Eric, and it'll help you to get really up to snuff on the greatest threat to freedom that the world, has, in my mind, has ever seen, especially over the last 400 years, is the Jesuit order, and they control, again, the entire mechanism of Papal Rome, plus the highest levels of Freemasonry. They sit at the very top of the secret society's pyramid. Let me just give them a couple, about three more websites that just, they've got tons of great articles up there. And I was amazed. I was up on Chuck Wilcox's website probably about a week ago, and he just has a whole lot of articles up there about Papal Rome. And that's C.T. Wilcox, like Charlie Tango, C.T. Wilcox, WILCOX.com. Go up there and click on articles, and you'll see he's got a lot up there on financial stuff and pedophilia and all other kinds of stuff about Papal Rome. If you want to see a lot of photographs, go up to SpirituallySmart.com. That's Thomas Richards' website. A ton of pictures that'll show, oh, the bushes with Knights of Columbus, a whole bunch of foreign leaders bowing down to the Pope and his representatives. So that's spirituallysmart.com. Take advantage of these while the website's there. I don't think it's going to be up there forever. And another one is arcticbeacon.com. He's got a lot of good articles, especially about doctrinal issues with Roman Catholicism. arcticbeacon.com. And those are just some websites that will give you lots of information about Papal Rome. One more article I wanted to mention about that's on my website, and you were nice enough to have me on, I think about three or four times. We covered the 22 reasons why Roman Catholics should come out of the Roman Catholic system, and that's under Urgent Appeal to Roman Catholics on my website, toughissues.org. If you're a Roman Catholic, I think you need, well, whether you're Roman Catholic or non-Roman Catholic, if you call yourself a Christian, you need to get up there and take a look at that, because I listed reasons or ways that Papal Rome blasphemes God, God the Father, the Son of God, and the Holy Spirit of God through the use of their titles of Holy Father, Vicarius Christi, and what's the other one? Help me out here. Oh, it's Vicarius Filii Dei, which is the vicar of Son of God, which is the
that's
Holy
right.
Spirit. So that's a pretty serious charge. So if you're a Roman Catholic, I'd really urge you to go up there and take a look at that. And there's some Bible verses in there, too. And I know Eric and I and some others are hoping that many Roman Catholics will be liberated from that system, come out of it, as they're told to do in Revelation 18:4. And we covered Brother Eric before. If they'll read, about Revelation chapters 13 through 17, especially in part of 18, they're going to see that their church, Papal Rome, is clearly identified as the entity that God is telling in Revelation 18:4 is people to come out of it, come out of her. And again, you know, it sits on seven hills, drunk with the blood of the saints. Take a look at the Inquisition. I had mentioned earlier that I wanted to mention about a couple items that I had mentioned before that people could get, and I had given them an address. Well, now when I was down at Barnes & Noble a couple days ago, I checked and to see if they had Roman Catholicism by Lorraine Bettner, and they sure do. So if you have a local Barnes & Noble, you can go down there and buy Roman Catholicism by Lorraine Bettner, Bettner, for $12.99, I believe, is what they told me. And they had to order it from their warehouse, but they do carry it. So while they carry it, I'd urge you, whether you're a Catholic or a non-Catholic, you need to have this book and then share it with other Roman Catholics, because Bettner sits down in a very calm and cool manner and just compares Scripture with the unscriptural doctrines and practices of the Roman Catholic Church. It's a pretty good-sized book, and they have the same paperback version that I have. It's originally put out in 1962, and I'm looking here to see how many pages. It's 400 and looks like 64 pages, and it's got a good subject index in the back, which I always like in a book. I also talked to Richard Bennett. He's the one that has the DVD, The Inquisition, 605 Years of Papal Torture and Death. It's 58 minutes long. I had, on a number of recent broadcasts, mentioned that he sells it for $6 postage paid. Well, with the increase in postage in that, he's raised that to $8. That's still a great deal for a 58, very professionally made DVD called The Inquisition that he allows you to make copies of. So it's $8 postage paid, and you can find out how to get that by going up on BereanBeacon.org. Berean, like the Bereans in the Bible, B-E-R-E-A-N, Beacon.org. He also, as I mentioned, he has a lot of articles up there, especially dealing with Roman Catholic doctrine. But I think it's kind of important, Brother Eric, that they know about the Inquisition. And by the way, the last third of that DVD deals with that horrible, pretty much forgotten, as Greg Szymanski says, the forgotten Holocaust that occurred in World War II in Croatia. And so you can see he has a lot of photographs, and that from that Holocaust, I call it a religious genocide that was perpetrated by choreographed by two Roman Catholic Monsignors who were in archbishop positions in Zagreb and Sarajevo, respectively, Aloysius Stepanić and Ivan Saric, and these two butchers organized that Holocaust that took the lives of up to 1 million innocent Serb Orthodox Christian men, women, and children simply because they were not Roman Catholic. It included forced conversion. Of course, then to make sure that they didn't change their mind, they would slit their throats immediately after they converted to Catholicism. But the majority of these Serb Orthodox Christians refused to convert. Many of them died before they even made it to the camps, but the camps, interestingly, were run frequently by Franciscan priests, monks, and friars. One of them got interesting name of King of the Cutthroats because of so many throats that he slit in one night. But these Franciscan priests, monks, and friars often the killer Ustashi squads, they were right along as advisors participating in and advising them how to torture these people. And they, in the end of the 20th century there, 1941 to 1945, they were not content just to murder these innocent Serb Orthodox Christian men, women, and children. But they tortured both of them brutally before murdering them. They people alive. They buried people alive. They burned people alive. They impaled children alive on sharpened stakes in the ground. They cut babies out of mothers' wombs. They crucified Orthodox priests to wooden doors. And some things I can't even describe over the air.
Often, as I said, either led by or...
That's right.
Monks and friars. Manhattan called it the Vatican Holocaust, and that's why I think it's critical that people don't get this idea. And some Catholics try to backpedal and say, all that stuff about burning people at the stake, that was, you know, that was 1,000 years ago. No, the Inquisition ran to 1808. As a matter of fact, some of Napoleon's troops, when they went into Madrid, I think it was a Dominican fortress or that, but whenever they broke into it, the monks denied that there were any torture chambers or anything, and I think the one military officer had them pour water or something on the floor, and where it seeped down, they lifted it up and sure enough found a whole bunch of people down. In 1808, I believe it was, people were still being tortured by the Roman Catholic Church under their Inquisition. They cried and whined when it was taken away from them. But we need to remember that, it was even in the late 20th century that they carried out on a gigantic scale within Croatia, a modern-day Inquisition. And I believe, Brother Eric, that they got the same exact thing planned here for the United States of America with their 10 FEMA regions and their 10 Jesuit provincials. And all of us, we need to get out of denial about this, or don't think about it, it's going to go away. It's not going to go away. These people are clearly running our country. They control the top levels of the international intelligence community, especially the Brits in the United States and the KGB, which became the FSB, and what was the other thing, Eric, they became?
SVR, overseas.
That other acronym.
SVR.
Anyway, are you there, Eric?
Yeah, can you hear me, Daryl?
I don't hear Eric. I hope we're still on.
Can you
but
hear me?
Anyway, we didn't get a chance to talk about Oscar Romero.
Well, we're going to have to go, Daryl. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we're going to have to hit Oscar Romero some other time. But people need to really know about that Inquisition, don't they, Eric?
Right. Hey, well, thanks for being with me, Daryl, and the Lord bless, and I'll have you on again next Tuesday.
Okay, God bless you. Bye now.
Okay, bye-bye. It's Brother Eric John Phelps, Biblical Truth and History and Prophecy, with my dear friend and brother in Christ, Daryl Eberhart. If you wish to support this ministry, this broadcast, please send your donations to First Amendment Radio, care of Nicholas, and he will apply it to the broadcast. As he is kind enough to give me this broadcast for nothing, I don't give him a penny. So he has been very gracious and very kind. So please support First Amendment Radio. Again, thank you for tuning in. I intend to do a special broadcast on the Vatican's court Jews who control AIPAC, American Jewish Congress, World Jewish Congress, all of them, how they are totally beholden to the Pope of Rome. Until tomorrow, the Lord bless you as you serve Him according to His Word, the AB 1611. Maranatha.